So good to be with you this morning. And for the Sunday school hour was a blessing, and I pray and trust it was a blessing and encouragement. And we are the Villareal family, or the La Familia Villareal, and we are missionaries in Mexico. I am Hispanic. Both sides of my parents' sides are from Mexico. The family of Villareales, they come from Reynosa area, and the familia Rodriguez, which is my mother's maiden name, that's what they call it, right? Maiden name. And my mother's, you know, she was born with, of course, her last name before she got married, and they're from the Monterrey area. And so I am second generation American. My first generation was my parents. They were born in the United States, and then my dad joined the military, and then, of course, came the rest of us, the kids. And I was born in Indiana. I was raised in the as a military dependent for many years, and all the way up to I was 18, 19 years old. I was military dependent, and my dad was stationed in many parts of the country. Also stationed in Ethiopia. We were stationed in Hawaii and Germany as well, and We got to see a lot of different places. When we were in Ethiopia, we got to see many different areas there. I was not a Christian then, but I think back and wish I had been a Christian. So many people I could have witnessed to back then in that area as well. But We have been serving now for over 20 years in the country of Mexico. God had called us there back in 1993, 92, I think it was 91 or 92, right around there. God called us to go to Mexico to be missionaries, and we were. Pastor, I forgot to turn this thing on. I forget these devices. Let's see how. Is there a circuit? I don't want to break it. That thing's plastic. Let's see here. Somewhere around here. Yeah. Okay, yeah. Wonderful. Thank you, preacher. I need all the help I can get. Coming to the States, I'm so used to doing things differently there in Mexico, and we don't have too much modern technology down there, but that's all right. We do well as it is, and our church is not as large as this. We have a little bit smaller congregation, much smaller. But we rejoice and thank God for what the Lord has given to us. And we were called to that country back in 1990, 91, right around there. And Lord, as then from there, led us to start a work in Nuevo Laredo, Mexico, and then from there, Lord, after that furlough started, we went in deputation, furlough, and then during furlough, that's when the Lord spoke to us to go down further into the interior of Mexico, and so we've been down there in that area now close to over 17 years in the area that we're at in the state of Jalisco. We're right in the heart of Mexico, and we rejoice and thank God for His calling our lives. Our town is about close to 65,000-70,000 people. It's growing. It's a growing town, but our town is also growing in sin and in wickedness. It has been known, and it's always been known as a town of a haven for witchcraft, demonology, prostitution, drugs, and also drug cartel. In fact, I mentioned about the drug cartel just the other, was it about 3 weeks ago, right before my son got married. He has a certain area in our town, well, right outside of our house, about maybe three blocks down. There's an open area there, and he just takes time and just prays. And the sky is beautiful, it's so clear. And he'll just get on his knees and start praying and calling the Lord. Well, one day before his marriage, and it's about 3 weeks ago, he decided to take a friend with him to go out there in that area and pray. And as he was walking up, he saw a car parked right where, you know, right close, right next to where he bows his knees and calls upon the Lord and prays and just shares everything and express everything to the Lord. And he sees that car there. And so he puts a flashlight, and it's a black Suburban, black windows. I mean, just tinted to the T. You can't even see in it. But he shines that light right through that tinted window, and he sees somebody in there. The guy rolls down the window, and he says, "What do you want? And why are you here?" And my son said to him, "Oh, we're out here to pray." And he said, "Well, let me talk to my boss about that." And he was talking to his boss, and his boss, he put a phone up to my son's ear. And his boss was cussing and swearing and everything and threatening. He was going to take him out, kill him and everything, and if he doesn't get out of that area. And so so he said, "Okay, now you know what my boss thinks." And my son, Stephen, didn't say a word. And the guy there in the car said, "You need to get out of here as soon as you can." And so my son started walking back the way he came. And he said, "Oh, no, not that way. That way, out into the field where there's nothing out there." So my son and his friend, his name is Gino, they both walked out to the field. And as they walked out to the field, the guy yelled out to him. He said, "If I ever see you here again, they will find you on the other side of the river." And you know what that means. They're going to take him out. They'll kill him. And so my son and Gino, they took off and they ran out. My son knew the area well enough. And so he was able to come back to the main road, main highway, and come back around to our house. And so I told my son, I said, "Don't do that again. Please don't do that again." I said, "At nighttime, you know, times change." He said, "But Dad, I always went out there. I always pray." I said, "Yes, I understand. But you've not been here for a while." Times change. Things are different. The drug cartels, they move in different areas. And he said, "But Dad, they're going to come after us. They've already looked at us. They've already seen who we are. They know who I am." I said, "Yeah, they've known who you were. They know who I am. And if they wanted us, they would have already taken us out. They've already killed us or... sequestrar is kidnap. They've already kidnapped us and taken us for hostage or something." But I said, "Don't worry about it. God's going to take care of us." And so times change, folks. And the area and where we're living there, sometimes some drug cartels will come in and take over. There'll be killings. They'll throw grenades at the police station and blow it up, and then they'll shoot people random on the side of the streets. And one fellow that lived right up the road from us, he walked down across the street, go to the pharmacy to get some medication for the baby. And three or four drug cartel fellows came out and beat him to the pulp. He should have been dead. The doctor said he should have been dead. They fractured him, fractured his skull and broken his arms and everything. But he made it back home, all the way back up the hill, and then from there they rushed him to the hospital. So we live in a dangerous area. But God's with us, and greater is He that is in us than he that is in the world. And my friends, also, I think it's through the prayers of the saints. You might think, "Well, I want to pray for the Villareal family, and I hope something happens to them. I hope they're going to be..." We should not think that way. I don't believe so. I think we're just praying, "God, they're in your hands. God, I have faith that you will take care of them and help them." And believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Believe his promises. Believe that our prayers are reaching him. And that God's going to answer our prayers. Your prayers, the prayers of the righteous man, is efficacious. It's powerful. And we need your prayers as we continue ministering the gospel down there in this area. And we are, I was just talking to somebody, I forget who it was. I don't know if it was pastor. I've talked to so many people sometimes. I don't know who I talked to, but I was sharing with him how that I would rather live in a area such as that, volatile and dangerous and wicked, but know I'm in God's will, than to live in a garden of roses where everything's so peaceful, out of God's will. Why is that? Because in a garden of roses, there's bees. In a garden of roses, there's insects. There's also some diseases. And just one thing, one small thing, can take you out, can take your life. And so I'd rather be in a dangerous area, knowing I'm in God's will, than to be anywhere else in this world. Question is this: are you living in God's will? Are you doing what is right? Are you following the Lord Jesus Christ and putting your faith in Him? Let's go to the Word of God this moment here. Let me introduce my wife real quick. We got a presentation coming up here. I just forgot about that. My wife, I don't want to forget her. Never forget her. She's my right-hand man. She's my right-hand woman. She helps me out tremendously. You would not imagine, folks. If it wasn't for her faithfulness and her drive and desire and her prayer and making sure I stay close to God, we would not be in Mexico either. I thank God for a godly wife that desires her children also to grow in the... let me introduce you. My wife, Julie. This is my wife, Julie. Oh, she played the accordion out here. By the way, she's the one that played the accordion up here, okay? She loves playing and serving the Lord, and just like the rest of her siblings, they're all serving the Lord. We rejoice and thank the Lord for that. Okay, before I go any further, Pastor, let's go ahead and put that presentation up, okay? Let me share one thing about this presentation. This presentation is about the scenery in our town, okay? I have another presentation. It's in the workings, I wish it would have been done by now, but the fellas got tied up. But it brings out more about our family involved directly with people. But this is a presentation, 5-minute presentation only, that's going to share about our town, what it looks like, and different areas. But it's something to give us an idea, a vision as to where we're at, what it looks like, and to pray for our town. Pastor, can we go ahead and do that?
This is Incarnation of Days, Jalisco, Mexico. Here you see some of the beautiful aspects of our town, such as the pottery, railroads, birds, and many other interesting surroundings. Traditions that lead to moments of festivity play a big part in the culture of our town. As you can see, right in the center of our town sits the main Catholic cathedral and the beautiful Plaza Square. There are two main entrances to our town. One is from the north and one from the south. As you reach the downtown area, you may cross an old bridge like this, rarely with any water flowing by. And on the outskirts, you can see the old railroad station. Many highlights throughout the year draw attention from the outside, such as a community fair, which is a favorite activity for many children, and rodeos, and also traditional dance performances. Due to the extreme Catholicism, various times throughout the year, fireworks go off day and night. Some say that it helps get the Virgin's attention. In the historic mausoleum of La Chona, you will see hundreds of sepulchres and vaults in the walls, and right behind sits a museum of mummies. After the pagan holiday of Halloween, the Catholics celebrate the Day of the Dead by holding festivities with traditional dances, rodeos, and a lot of food in order to honor and pay respects to family members who have passed on. Altars of candles, flowers, and food are made and set out either in front of their houses or at the grave sites. As mentioned before, there is a museum of mummies that is a center of attraction for tourists from all over. The guides, who speak both English and Spanish, will tell the history of how they died, and several of the deaths were quite gruesome. There are mummified bodies from various stages of life, from elderly folks to young persons, and even a mummified embryo of an infant. There is an auditorium called the House of Culture, where a variety of fine art classes are offered to the public. Here in Mexico, they have their own version of Groundhog Day, climbing up a greased pole to get the gifts. You are entering an area populated by nearly 65,000 inhabitants, which continues to increase This place is surrounded by over 20 community ranches, which can consist of anywhere between 50 to 2,000 people. Jesus hath said, "Ye are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, and it giveth light unto all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men, that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven." My dear friends, we ask that you pray for us as we continue serving here in Mexico. The people are precious, but they are lost. The people are religious, but they have not the truth. The people have life, but their souls are condemned. Help us to open their eyes and to turn them from darkness to light and from the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and inheritance among them which are sanctified by faith that is in me. Acts chapter 26 and verse 18.
Amen. Shall we turn to the book of Acts, chapter 26? And shall we stand to our feet, please? Acts chapter 26. Acts chapter 26 and verse 19. The Bible says in Acts chapter 26 and verse 19, it says, "Whereupon, O King Agrippa, I was not disobedient unto the heavenly vision, but showed first unto them of Damascus and in Jerusalem and throughout all the coasts of Judea and them to the Gentiles, that they should repent and turn to God and do works meet for repentance. For these causes the Jews caught me in the temple and went about to kill me. Having therefore obtained help of God, I continue unto this day, witnessing both to small and great, saying none other things than those which the prophets and Moses did say should come, that Christ should suffer, and that he should be the first that should rise from the dead, and should show light unto the people and to the Gentiles." Lord Jesus, we thank you, Father, for this day, for this moment, for this time, for this service, dear Lord. And I pray, Father, that you would be the blessed pastor and his wife and his family. Bless us all, dear God, in this moment, Father, as we go to thy word, that we might be strengthened, helped, and also encouraged, dear Lord, for we need it much. And Father, thank you also, dear Lord, for this time we just share about Mexico. Bless thy word, bless thy servant. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. You may be seated. We'll be back over here after the service. At the table there, if you have any questions, feel free to ask us, and we'd like to help you out any way we possibly can. But here we find in the book of Acts, Paul the surrendered servant, and not only in the book of Acts, but throughout the other books of the epistles that were written about him and by him, of course, we find that this information was given to us that we might better know Paul and how God used Paul. How God works in the lives of those that are surrendered for the cause of Christ. And we find right here that Paul was obedient to the vision that God had showed him, that God expressed and showed to him on that day. And Paul shares this witness and this testimony. And he desires that because this vision did not come from man. This vision did not come supernaturally from somebody else or somewhere else. No, this vision came from God. In Scripture, a revelation from God, an appearance or exhibition of something supernaturally presented to the minds of the prophets by which they were informed of future events. Such were the vision of Isaiah, Amos, Ezekiel, Daniel, Paul, and others. The vision was not rejected. We find that the vision was from God, not from Mary or not from the Pope. We find that the vision is for souls. In Proverbs 29, verse 18, we know that verse there, where there is no vision, the people perish. But he that keepeth the law, happy is he. And where there is no vision, the people will perish. When God called me to come to Mexico, I did not have a vision or a desire or really cared about going to Mexico. Yeah, I cared for the Mexican people, and my background's Hispanic and from Mexico. My parents were bilingual. My grandparents did not speak any English, hardly at all, and very little English, very little. But when God spoke to my heart and showed me His will, and led me and called me to go to Mexico, folks, that was all I needed. That was my vision. And it was not like a vision through seeing something like God did come to the prophets in different ways and bringing them a vision, like he did it in a different way with the Apostle Paul as well. But God worked in my heart through the Holy Spirit in a way that I could not see myself being anywhere else in this world but in Mexico preaching the gospel. Well, I surrendered to that. I surrendered to God's calling in my life. And God called me and God directed me to go to Mexico. And I was surrendered to God's will. I was already surrendered to God's will. I already wanted to do God's will. I did not want to go to Mexico because, well, I wasn't called. You know, who in their right mind want to go take their kids to Mexico and the whole family and wife and everybody? And well, that's what my thinking was. But even so, I was not called. But when God did call me, wow, Lord, I'm just as good as there. All the fear, intimidation, and not desiring, it's all gone. I've got to go. And folks, it was so... The impression was so strong in my heart that let me share this with you. The three nights in a row, God was dealing with me about that, just an overwhelming desire and burden for Mexico. I never had that before in my life. So the third night that we surrendered to go to Mexico, my wife and I, we got about 2:00 in the morning. We got up and I said, "Sweetheart, I can't sleep. I believe God is dealing with me. Go to Mexico." We got on our knees and said, "Lord, if it's your will, so let it be." Well, after that yielding and praying and saying, "God, we will," that morning I got up and went to work. But that morning, my wife received a phone call from her dad. On the other side, he was in Texas. I was in South Carolina at the time and working with a church in South Carolina. Well, she got a phone call from her dad. And her dad said to her, "Sweetheart, Julie, I just want to let you know, I don't know, I could not sleep last night. I was praying all night that God would just work in your hearts in a mighty way. I believe God's going to call you to go to Mexico." And she said, "Dad, guess what?" No, what, sweetheart? "He did call us and we surrendered last night." He said, "Well, praise God, hallelujah. That's why God had me up all night last night praying." And so that was a strong confirmation for us. And so there were other confirmations God gave us. But so when God called us, folks, we had to be there. We had to go. In fact, if I could at that moment step out in my car and boom, I'd go straight to Mexico. But God had a reason for us to hold back. We went on deputation, and we got the support that we needed. But not only that, we got prayer support that we much, much needed. And going down into the interior. And so, as we went down, we were surrendered. We were obedient to this calling in God's life. For our lives and everything. You know, there was two English missionaries who attempted to reach the inhabitants of the New Hebrides islands in South Pacific. They were killed and they were eaten by the cannibals. Only a few minutes after they arrived, they were killed and they were eaten. For some time after that, no one else was willing to go there with the gospel to those islands. Finally, in 1858, John Peyton and his wife determined to risk the dangers to reach the lost of those islands. One of the elders of the church discouraged the effort, warning him, "You will be eaten by cannibals." John Peyton responded, "Mr. Dickerson, you are advanced in years now, and your own prospect is soon to be laid in the grave. There to be eaten by worms, I confess to you that if I can but live and die serving and honoring the Lord Jesus, it will make no difference to me whether I am eaten by cannibals or by worms." You see, the world tells us that we should cling to our lives and do everything possible to defend them. But God's call for us is different. He values the eternal over the temporal. And he is not looking for people to be focused on this life. The Christian life is not about being safe and comfortable. It is about investing in the eternal. And that requires self-denial and sacrifice. Taking up the cross to follow Jesus is a descriptive metaphor. Dr. Curtis Hudson used to say, "A crucified man has no plans of his own for the future." Rather than focusing on how we can get the most for ourselves, like Jesus, we should focus on how we can give the most to others. Yes, Paul was obedient to the vision. Paul was yielded to the commission. Here in verse 20, we find in Acts chapter 26 in verse 20, "But showed first unto them of Damascus and at Jerusalem, and throughout all the coast of Judea, and then to the Gentiles, that they should repent and turn to God and do works meet for repentance." Yes, the Great Commission. "Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you even unto the end of the world. I am with you always, even unto the end of the world." Yes. "But ye shall receive power. After that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth." Paul was yielded to the commission. God called Paul. Paul was a man that was surrendered and obedient to the vision. But he was a man that was yielded to the commission. There was no other thing he wanted to do in this life but to serve God. Well, one would say, well, brother, I have a business. How in the world can I serve God? Oh, yes, you can serve God. Oh, brother, I my wife used to clean houses. And she used to work. I would work. We would witness and tell and share the gospel. Wherever you go, whatever business, whatever work you have. Okay, so they restrict you in your business. They say you cannot talk to them about God, or else they'll fire you. Well then, we'll just pray. God, there's got to be another way. Show me that way, Lord, so I can witness to the people in this company. And that's what happened to me. I used to work for a company called Pilcher Hamilton Corporation, the world's largest manufacturer of polyester film there in South Carolina. And I loved my job, and I worked there. And I was doing well. They wanted to move me up to a supervisor's position within a year and a half almost. I just worked there. They wanted to move me up. But my desire was to witness to everybody in the whole company. They shut me down. They told me I could not talk to the people about God, about the Lord anymore. And I talked to the one fella, the supervisor that was over me, and I said to him, "Bill, I said, I would like to somehow talk to them about the Lord." He said, He said to me, he said, not in this business, you can't do that. I said, okay. Mr. Bill, do you try to witness to the people? I mean, you go to a Baptist church. Do you try to talk to people around here about the Bible? He said, no, I don't. They'll find God in their own way. They can turn the radio on. They can watch TV. Okay. Later on, I found out Mr. Bill was a Mason, a Freemason. And later on, I talked to him about that, and he told me, he said, Mr. Villareal, I don't want to talk about religion. You've got your religion, and I've got mine. I said, you're right. Freemasonry is a religion, but it's a false religion. I thought he was going to fire me right then, but he didn't. But I say all that is because God opened the door for me to witness and talk to the whole company before I left the company and yielded to go to Mexico. You see, the boss, about a year and a half, 2 years before, had accepted Jesus Christ as his personal Savior on Christmas Day. And he wanted somebody in the company to stand up before the whole company and give the Christmas story. Now, I just started working there. That business has been in business for many, many, 30, 40, 50 years, maybe 40, 34, 35, 40 years almost. But Mr. Bill came to me, the Freemason man, and he said, Mr. Villareal? I said, yes, sir. He said, the boss wants you to give the Christmas story. You want to do it? Okay, Christmas story? Well, what's that all about? He said, well, we're going to have a big banquet at the end of the holidays, and he wants you to get up and give a Christmas story. And so I got up, and praise the Lord. I gave the Christmas story, but I also gave the story of how Jesus Christ came to die. What was he was born to die upon Calvary. He came to be born to die for us. And I present the whole gospel, to the whole company. God opened the door. So we can be a witness wherever we go, my friends. You know, Moody told the story of a Scottish preacher who, before his conversion, had been a wicked man, fighting and gambling made him well known in the community. After he was saved, he began preaching the gospel. One night, as he prepared to go to the pulpit in another town, someone handed him an envelope. Inside was a list of awful things he had done in that town. And this man, wicked man, well known, he debated what to do for a moment. Then stepped to the pulpit and began to speak. He said, friends, I am accused of crimes and sins committed to this very city. I will read them to you. One after another, he read these charges, and at the conclusion of each, he said, I am guilty. When he had finished the whole list, he paused for a moment and then said, you ask how I dare come to you and speak of righteousness and truth with a list of crimes like that against my name? I will tell you, this is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptation, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. And he was chief of sinners in that city. But he is now a born-again believer in Christ Jesus, saved by the grace of God. Someone that is washed by the blood of Jesus Christ. On the cross of all our sins were laid on Jesus Christ. He completely and forever paid the debt for all those who trust in Him for salvation. The amazing sacrifice of love that Christ made on the cross and the fulfillment of His promise of the resurrection give us the wonderful and certain hope of eternal life. Nothing in our past can take away this great gift. Yes, Paul was obedient to the vision. Paul was yielded to the commission, but Paul was needful of a provision, and God delivered him, and God provided for him, and God helped him, and the Lord's help was upon him, witnessing to all of what Moses and the prophets had said, that Christ should suffer, that Christ should rise from the dead, that Christ should show light unto the people and Gentiles. Yes, Paul was that man. that was surrendered. Paul was that man that obeyed the vision. Paul was that man that yielded to the commission. Paul was that man that God provided and provided for all his needs. I'd like to end with this. In witnessing and sharing, talking to others about Jesus Christ, that's what Paul's heartbeat was. Because he had the heartbeat of Jesus. And that's the heartbeat of every Christian. As to how am I going to witness and share the gospel to those. But there's those that they're just evil. Just evil. Wicked. They'll cuss you right in the middle of the street or right in the store. Like they did me. Like they did to my wife. But we love them anyway. We pray for them. But we've got to witness. You lived next door to me for years, is the name of this poem. You lived next door to me for years. We shared our dreams, our joys and tears. A friend to me you were indeed. A friend who helped me when in need. My faith in you was strong and sure. We had such trust as should endure. No words between us ever rose. Our friends were alike, and so our foes. What sadness then, my friend, to find that after all, you were not so kind. The day my life on earth did end, I found you weren't a faithful friend. For all those years we spent on earth, you never talked of the second birth. You never spoke of my lost soul and of the Christ who'd make me whole. I'm lost today, eternally. And tell you now my earnest plea. You cannot do a thing for me. No words today. My bonds will free. But do not err, my friend, again. Do all you can for souls of men. Plead with them now quite earnestly, lest they be cast in hell with me. Acts 26, verse 18. To open their eyes and to turn them from darkness to light and from the power of Satan to God, that they may receive the forgiveness of sins and inheritance among them which are sanctified by faith that is in me. Shall we stand? Our gracious Heavenly Father, you are so kind. Oh God, you sent somebody our way to tell us about Jesus. There's people we come across every day. Oh God, help us not to pass up the opportunity to share with them the wonderful truth that Jesus saves. Yes, most will reject, but there are some that are searching, looking, wanting. Oh God, that we would give them that opportunity. Paul's desire was to burn for Jesus Christ. Paul's desire was to be obedient, surrender, and give everything to the Lord. His life, his mind, his heart, his soul. Because God is true. God is alive. And as God shows us in his word, there is a heaven, there's also a hell. And God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Help us, dear God, as servants of Christ, as children of God, that we would do our part in being faithful to you, in witnessing to those that are around us. And help us, dear Lord, be sensitive to the Holy Spirit. But we never know when God might bring someone our way that's truly searching and wanting to know. But, oh God, that we would not push them away, not neglect them because we're so busy, but that we just take the time and help and encourage and also, dear Lord, be sensitive to their needs, their spiritual needs especially. Bless us, help us. Thank you for this service. Thank you for your love and mercy. For these things we pray in Christ's name. Amen. Pastor.